Everybody,
Hosanna
to the King.
Hosanna,
wave and sing.
Hosanna,
woo! Jumping in a van, Lord, and up in the air. This music so sweet, there's just nothing to compare. Hey, if you see that angels parried in the streets, and then to my surprise, it's full on the feet. I watch an African with his tendons, yeah, Caucasian and Chinese, and then the master of the ceremony shouted something to me. It's an all-inclusive, feel the celebration.
All-inclusive,
this is jubilation. And
all-inclusive,
yeah man, Jesus is really can't conceive
up in heaven.
All the pleasures that your spirit will receive. So many mansions in the Father's house,
yeah,
filled with precious jewelry. So many races represented, but there's room for everybody. In the
all-inclusive,
universal vibration.
All-inclusive,
heavenly sensation.
All-inclusive,
yeah man, and Jesus is the promoter.
All-inclusive,
on the road, people dancing in the street.
Good night to you and Radio Land. This is The Hour of Truth with Brother Rennie G on Choice Radio. One more time, The Hour of Truth is brought to you at 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. on Sunday nights on Choice Radio. Well, I'm sure you've been having a wonderful time if you've been listening to the radio for the afternoon, into the evening, into the night. It was really, really some great upbeat music and good comments in between. And I just want to give God thanks for Choice Radio and the ministry here that offers you stuff that's edifying and can bless your soul and also can challenge you to come to the Lord Jesus Christ and let Him be your personal Savior and Lord. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Well, I'm not going to do any less, but continue with the pace. Caribbean gospel music. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. To the Christian, it's a holy crusade, and Jesus is the superstar. Bless the Lord. Hope you had a wonderful day today. Lord's Day, first day of the week.
Hosanna, 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 Hosanna.
Worshipping the Lord Jesus Christ. Worshipping Elohim, the living God who created all the ends of the earth. The God who loves you and me.
Hosanna, Hosanna. Hey, hey. Celebration.
Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. We worship the Lord. We worship the Lord. It is good to know that we are in the truth, for Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Feel it.
And Jesus left no other options.
Feel it.
Well, this is The Hour of Truth with Brother Rennie G on Choice Radio on a Sunday night.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, rejoicing in the Lord Jesus Christ. Hosanna. Hosanna to him who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glory to the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Just want to say tonight that it's a pleasure being in the house of the Lord today. And there were lots of things said. The message was great. And one of the things highlighted was, we must not keep unconfessed sins in our lives. In other words, we must not cover our sins, but we must confess them. Repentance is one thing, but also confession must be made. And, you know, that point was really underscored. And unconfessed sins in our lives can wreak havoc in our lives. It can block the blessings of God, you know. So we can't take sin lightly. Think twice before you sin against God, because you're going to have to repent and you're going to have to confess if you love the Lord and you're truly born again. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. David slew the enemy, and you can too. And before I get into some last days stuff and so on, let me just open in a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I lift my hands in gratitude to you for your grace and for your mercies. Hallelujah. It is through your grace and mercies that I am not consumed by your wrath, by your holiness. Lord God, it is through your grace and mercies I am existing and can stand in your presence at this time. Your favor, Lord God, which is your grace, unmerited favor. Thank you for it, Lord God. Thank you for your love. Thank you for divine providence in so many ways. Thank you for the church. Thank you for your Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost. Thank you for your word, the Bible, which easily proves itself to be true. And we've been talking about that, God, in this program, and I just praise your name for the evidence that your word is true. We can count on it. We can depend on it. Lord God, there is no error in your word. And we just thank you that we have your word today with us, so we can know your mind and we can know your will. We can know your plan for our lives. Lord God, I just give you thanks and I praise you, and I pray that the radio audience will be blessed. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Good night one more time to all the choice listeners in Radio Land. Good night to you, Robert Williams in Florida. And Annie Williams, Ryan Williams, good night to you. Brother Country Joe, good night.
Our bright God will help us fight. Which side are you standing?
Sister Lorian Frederick, good night to you.
On the Lord's side, let the enemy know that you have rights.
007 and beautiful wife, good night to you and welcome back to the good old Brooklyn land.
Jesus, rise up for Jesus. Shout out for Jesus.
DJ Vibes, good night. Georgette, good night.
The enemy know that you have rights. God will help us fight. Which side are you standing on? I'm standing on the Lord's side. Stand up for Jesus. Rise up for Jesus.
Rise up for Jesus. Stand up for Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jump up for Jesus. Let the enemy know that you have rights. God will help us fight. Which side are you standing on? I'm standing on the Lord's side. Stand up for Jesus. Rise up for Jesus. Shout out for Jesus. Jump up for Jesus. Hear what we're going to do.
Lord, one more time, let your Holy Spirit just take a hold of me, God, to share something that will be a blessing to the people in listening to this radio tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Put in your stuff, swing it around. Strike him down. Lay that up.
Oh, praise the name of Jesus. If I follow the music, I don't see nothing tonight. I just listen to music. But I got to stop the music a bit and get on with the teaching. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So we've been looking at on this program for the past many weeks. The authenticity of the Bible. And we continued along that line and dealing with different subtopics that provide evidence that the Word of God or the Bible is indeed authentic or true or dependable, reliable. All these are different words that we can use to describe the Bible. And we always say here, or I always say on this program, that without the Bible, a Christian has no authority. So the Bible is the book of authority of the Christian. And it is God's book, inspired by the living God. And today, the copy that we have is the King James Version, the new King James Version, for sure, authentic. true. And there are other versions also that are true. Praise the Lord. And there are some versions that are not true. There are some versions that man has made for his own, to meet his own ends. And we got to know the difference. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. In the last program, we were dealing with some last days prophecies. And one of the prophecies that I highlighted was the prevalence of the use of narcotics or drugs in the last days, as prophesied by the Lord in His Word. And it's in the book of Revelation. And I think I told you that I had to come back with the right text. And but what the text really, the text spoke about sorcery and so on. It didn't mention drugs. But when the word is translated sorceries in the prophecy, it means pharmakia. And pharmakia means drugs, or what we call narcotics. But there's a close link between the use of drugs or pharmakia and sorcery. So witchcraft and drugs kind of tie in together. Sorcery, witchcraft, you know, about the same thing. So now it's demonic. That is mind-altering drugs we're talking about. We're not talking about medicine for treating a disease or a complaint or a condition. And even though they have the side effects and probably might send you into a state of euphoria or abnormality or get your brain off track, make you drowsy or make you kind of a spaced out, even that's side effects of it. But you know, if you're using it for the right reason, for treating something, that's one thing. But if you're using it to get high, and that's another story. So now, but in the last days, the Bible says that people will be using drugs of pharmakia or sorcery, which in the translation of that word there in Revelation is pharmakia, which is drugs. We'll be using a lot of drugs in the last days. It will be an epidemic. And I show some statistics as to how much it costs the UK or England, the United Kingdom, to deal with the problems of drugs, and how much it costs the United States over a period of time. And I'm going to go back into it and look at these stats again, because we have something fresh for tonight. And but the use of drugs, illicit drugs or mind-altering drugs, is widespread or global. And just about everywhere you turn, in every society, there is the subculture where people are hooked on narcotics. They must get high. Whether it's marijuana, whether it's LSD, cocaine, crack. Even in some parts of the world where they can't even afford to buy those things, or these things are not available, they make something from wood. I think they make wood alcohol. Or some people make moonshine in the mountain. You know, different. But alcohol is also considered to be a drug, by the way. You know. So, in the last days, this will be very prevalent. And indeed, it is. And there is no point time in history, in the past, in human history, where it is recorded that narcotics or mind-altering substances will be so widespread in its use and so damaging to society like today. And when the prophecy was given, it was talking about the last days, and actually that was focused for the time after Jesus. So the trend is not only set, but the prophecy is being fulfilled right now. Has been fulfilling in the past, and it is still being fulfilled. And it's probably is going to be like that until the end of time. Until the end of time. And I just want to say, how does that apply to us as Christians? I'm saying that the prophecy must be fulfilled. We don't like the conditions. Of course, I hate the prevalence of drugs, especially drugs that could affect me, like marijuana, the secondhand smoke. It does its number, a job on me, I'm telling you. And I don't really like it. I wish I didn't have to deal with it. Sometimes I say, when I get to heaven, I want to ask God, God, why did you ever make marijuana? Because this smoke doesn't do me well at all. And I get it everywhere. And it does have its effect and make me feel so awful. But God made it for medicinal purposes, and God is all wise, and He made everything for a reason. But human beings use things for the wrong reasons. You could take something very precious and use it for the wrong reason, and cause problems. And so and tonight I just want to tell believers, your children are an heritage for the Lord. And you have to talk to your children very, very frequently about drugs in this society and anywhere you live, as a matter of fact. But you have to talk to them that they stay away from company of or friends or acquaintances or peers who are using drugs. Stay away from the atmosphere where drugs are being used, whether marijuana or cocaine, and even you could go as far as tobacco. Because tobacco is also harmful, and alcohol. And warn your children and keep them on the right track. Love them. You know, one of the things they say you can do is have dinner with your children. Sit down and eat with your children, whether it's breakfast or dinner or what have you, and talk to your children. There is some correlation between children who sit at dinner with the parents and the children who don't sit at to have dinner with the parents. And the propensity for them to use drugs. That is, those who eat with their parents will most likely not use drugs. And those who eat with their parents, most likely will not use drugs. And those who don't eat with their parents together on a table and stuff like that, most likely will use drugs. And I don't know the reasoning behind that, but there's a correlation, they say. Probably at the table you talk about a lot of things, and the children feel more at home. And eating is a very you can't call it a ritual, but it's a very important thing. I'll use the word thing here, in our lives as human beings. And when you eat with somebody, there's a bonding that takes place. And I don't want to go into all of that, but Jesus, if you notice, he always eating with his disciples. And people who eat together, there's something going on, you know, a good, you know, relationship is being built and stuff like that. Anyhow, so talk to your children. Our children are an heritage for the Lord, and we don't want our children to be strung out and no drugs. We don't want them to fry their brains with cocaine, or we don't want them to get into the use of marijuana, as probably acceptable as it look in society now, because so many people are using it right across the board. And even politicians are trying to legalize it. Yet, it's the gateway drug that leads to the use of other drugs. In addition to that, from what I have researched, marijuana does irreversible damage to the human brain. It shrinks the brain, first of all, and it does irreversible damage to it. That's why people on marijuana don't think straight. That's true. Okay. So, we dealt with that the last time, and I just had to clear up that. Pharmakia was the word. And sorcery, they related, and which is equal to drugs, narcotics. So when mind-altering drugs are being consumed, the mind is altered and go into a state of euphoria or abnormality, and then demons are able to operate with this particular mind. You see, because the mind, you have lost the strength, self-will, and all of that stuff. You don't have the capacity to think as you were when you were sober. So demons come into play, and demons are all around us. So they come to play with your mind and cause you to sin more and more, and even you probably get more addicted and all of that stuff. So it's a very, very serious matter. And Christians' children are not exempted from falling to drug use. That's why you got to keep your children close. Again, I want to emphasize it, because you know why? Because God is counting on us to raise up godly seed in this evil and crooked generation. Now, don't expect the lost person to raise up godly seed. No, they're raising seed that is wild. But it's our children who is hearing the gospel, who is under our care, whom we're praying for and we loving and everything, and raising them up in the admonition of the Lord according to the word of God. They're the ones who most likely are going to take the gospel on, and people will get saved, of course, yes. But you know, hey, our children are a heritage for the Lord, and don't forget that. And God promised household salvation. And one of the greatest desires you could have for your children is that they be saved. But you know, they don't have to be messed up before they become saved. What's the sense? It doesn't make any sense. You got to be destroyed before you get saved? No, it doesn't make sense. The best testimony is you get saved young, and you stay faithful to the Lord and obedient to the Lord, and the Lord, you have a life of blessing and peace. You have salvation, and you have also, you don't have the bad memories of the past. You know, it's a good thing. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. bless the name of Jesus.
Hosanna!
Everybody!
Hosanna!
To the King!
Hosanna!
Well, tonight's topic, our topics tonight, will be four Bible prophecies of the last days, in these days, and we're going to look at a little bit of details about it and stats or statistics or evidence that is being fulfilled. I get into the statistics because I have to show you that the prophecy is being fulfilled, right? If I don't do that, then how would you know that prophecy? We just say it on the top of our heads and we say, okay, well, there's a situation, there's a situation in the world. And you know, but you know what? When I bring the stats, then you see, oh boy, this prophecy is really being fulfilled right now. Praise the Lord. So we're going to look at some prophecies, about four of them. If we have time, we're going to look at five. And prior to that, I'm going to look at just something in the book of 1 Peter chapter 1 and then James chapter 1 briefly. And it has to do with the fiery trials of your faith. Because I know while I'm dealing with all these things, the prophecies, it doesn't really, you know, it's not giving you a word, you know, of encouragement and stuff like that as you would get or glean from a particular text dealing with a specific thing, like the fiery trials of your faith. And I want to deal with this right now. And the text is 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 to 7. The fiery trial of your faith. Praise the Lord. And James also, James chapter 1, verse 2 to 4. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to that, these two texts. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 to 7.
Jesus is the promoter, all inclusive. On the road, people dancing in the street. All day, all night. There's a wonderful expression in the beat. All day, all night. An eternal celebration in the road. All day, forever and evermore. We sing, sing, sing. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Praise the name of Jesus Christ. The fiery trial of your faith. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 to 7. And it says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, true sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy had begotten us unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an heritage incorruptible and undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God, through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations. But the trial of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perisheth, though it be found unto the praise, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Let me read that again. Verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than the gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So listen, the highlight here is tried with fire. That is, though it be tried with fire, that's the gold, right? Even though gold is tried with fire, you know, that your faith, he's lightening the gold with, right? So now if your faith, the trial of your faith, it's been much more precious than that of gold. So now gold is tried in fire. Yes, so that it be purified. Now what about your faith? Your faith is also tried by fire. What does that mean? That's figurative, right? So it's not real literal fire, of course. We know that. But let me just turn to James chapter 1, verse 2 to 4. Praise the Lord. James chapter 1, verse 2 to 4. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Let patience have a perfect work, that he may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Praise the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. So now, these two texts of scripture, I just want to just do a little exhortation before I get into the prophecies. They're talking about the trying of our faith. And I just want to say that tonight, sooner or later, as a Christian, born again Christian, love the Lord, genuine, walking by faith, walking with the Lord, you love Jesus Christ. You're rejoicing in the saving grace of Jesus Christ. You are on fire for the Lord, so to speak. You winning the lost. You, as a matter of fact, you're making all efforts to take the gospel message to the lost. You're interested in that, and you are zealous, and you're active in church. But there is going to come times, not a time, and not one time, but there might be numerous occasions, or there will be numerous occasions throughout your lifespan, even as a Christian, when your faith will be tried in fire. What is this fire all about? That is adversity. Adversity. That is, you will be tested by adverse circumstances. And the Bible says, now count it all joy when your faith is being tested. Now the first thing you have to know as a Christian, when you are going through rough times or adversity or setbacks, you know, or difficulties or hard circumstances, just know this, that this must happen to you. It's happening to this brother over there. It has happened to this sister over there. It has happened to the people 100 years ago who were walking with the Lord. It has happened to the people in the first century. It has happened to people 20 years ago. Christians I'm talking about now. And it's going to happen to you as an individual. You know why? Because God knows you. God loves you. Now we always talk, we sometimes we generalize with God. You know, God loves us. Now talk about yourself now. God knows you. He knows your name. He knows where you live. He knows your heart. He knows your circumstances. He knows what he wants to do with your life. And he knows the events that he must orchestrate in your life to bring you to a point where you can know
that you believe, that you can know that you believe in him and trust in him, because he already know where your heart stands and where, and how much faith you have. But you got to know that now, and your faith has to be built up. So God will send some trials your way. And watch what you're going to do. But you're going to just, if you really flunk on that test, it's a real bad sign. It means that you're really not trusting in this living God that you say you believe in, right? So now we got to know when we're going to trials. First of all, that it's a test. Always tell yourself, this trial here is just a test. So now, can I count on the God that I say I believe in, who created this vast universe? This God of the Bible, God of truth, God who loves me, God who loves the world. Can I count on him to bring me safely through this trial? Whatever the outcome will be. But, you know, if I depend on God, he's going to see me through the trial, and I will come out on the other side as refined gold, pure gold. I might go through a real rough time, very, very hard, very hard circumstances, never give up. And then when I come out on the other side, I say, oh, I am so thankful to God that I went through this. You know, I've learned this, I've learned that, I'm stronger, I'm better, you know. And so tonight I just want to encourage Christians that are going through very rough times. And to tell you that you are not alone in trials. And trials come to make you become patient, and trials come to test you. And Job was there. And when you talk about trials, and you talk about tribulation and adversity, Job must come to your mind, because Job has been through severe testing. You know, Job was a wealthy man, and you know the story. Job was a wealthy man, then he had beautiful children, he had a beautiful wife, he had a lot of property, and then he was healthy, and then he lost all of that. And in addition to that, he was like the talk of the town. So it was not easy for Job. Even his friends made some remarks that were very discouraging to him. And so he lost everything, even his friends, because he couldn't trust them anymore. They weren't encouraging to him. And then God saw him through. And finally, God brought him out and delivered him and blessed him again. So now, you don't know, whatever you're going through, you don't know what's going to be the end result. Once you trust in God, there will be a good result. You don't know now. And the trial is very hard. But don't give up on God. Don't cease to trust in him and believe on him. You must have a kind of a radical, relentless faith in the living God. And many men of God in the Old Testament times, and even in the New Testament times, had this kind of relentless, steadfast faith in God. And the testimony was really great, that God had brought them out. God really brought deliverance. And God blessed them again. And not only Job, but Abraham was another example. Daniel, think about Daniel in the den of hungry lions. And Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Joseph, who was sold in slavery by his brothers to Egypt. And Elijah, who was a man of great faith, who prayed and was so victorious, prayed that the rain would not come for many years, and the rain ceased to fall for many years. And yet, Elijah went through a trial and became fearful and felt he had self-pity and asked God to kill him, take his life. He was afraid. You see, so, and it could happen to the best of us. But we have to know, I'm just exhorting tonight, whatever the trial is, I'm telling you, man, we go through a lot of stuff as Christians. But be encouraged that God is going to see you through the trial and through the test. Continue to believe on him, trust in him, depend on him. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord.
praise the name of Jesus Christ. Go on, my brother. Go on, my sister. Go on. In the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, tonight, I'm going to begin my the study on a few last days prophecies. And we're going to look at about four of them. And remember, we're still looking at the authenticity of the Bible. Even though I don't say that too much, but we have been looking at prophecies that are already being fulfilled and are still being fulfilled. And prophecies right now that I'm looking at are prophecies that are, the trend is set and also they're being fulfilled. So tonight we're going to look at a prophecy made by Jesus himself. And it's recorded in the book of Luke chapter 17 verse 26. And it reads as follows. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. Okay. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. Which means, in these days, in the AD period, Anno Domini, in the year of our Lord, the years of our Lord, in the days of the Son of Man, and in the last days, these days. Praise the Lord. So now, well, what was going on in the days of Noah that Jesus was really talking about? As in the days of Noah, so it's going to be in these days, these last days. Well, in the book of Genesis chapter 6, verse 11, gives the account of what really was happening in the days of Noah. And I'm going to start from verse 11. The earth, also was corrupt before God. And the earth was filled with violence. And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. And all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. And then God said, unto Noah, the end of all flesh is come before me. And the earth is filled with violence. The word violence again. Through them. And behold, I will destroy the earth with them. One of these days, we got to look at Noah's flood. It wasn't Noah's flood, but it was a flood that God sent and Noah was saved. And God used Noah as an instrument to preserve humankind and beast, all animals. But this is what was going on in the days of Noah. That is, there was violence in the earth. There were other things too, you know. But you think today, you think violence just started today? There was violence. What's that? Homicides. You know, they didn't have guns, but they had spear and they had sword and stuff like that. They made sharp objects to kill. They used stones, rocks. But there was violence in the earth. Now, this is the prophecy here that Jesus is talking about. The violence. The other things also, as in the day of Noah. A lot of other things characterize the day of Noah. But I'm looking tonight at the prophecy concerning violence in the earth. So now, the earth will be filled with violence. Just this one word from the book of Genesis. I want to look at. And God ended the old world for that. And then things picked back up again. And then mankind turned back to his old ways. But in the last days, the level of violence is different to the level of violence from after the flood, right down probably to the time of Jesus. Yes, there is a rise in violence all over the world. And I could prove that to you tonight. But I'm going to prove that to you. I'm going to give you some evidence. You know, I'm going to give you some evidence. I can't go into all the things to compare how it was back then. There's no record sometimes of some of things that happened. Yeah, there were fightings and so on. But we're talking about large-scale violence. Yeah, things like World War One. I give you an assignment. Find out for me how much people were killed in World War One. Go do some research now. And I'm going to give you it for me. And World War Two. Find out for me how many people were killed. That is on the record. Because a lot of people get killed and they're not on the record. But on the record, how many got killed in World War One and how many got killed in World War Two? You will marvel. You'll marvel. And that's just two wars. But there are other circumstances where people
got killed by the hundreds of thousands. But anyhow, coming back to the prophecy now. The earth will be filled with violence, according to Jesus, and it's going to be like in the days of Noah. So it tells us that in the day of Noah, it will, the days of Noah was something like these days here, in relation to the amount of violence that occurs. So violent crime now has increased. Well, let's talk about the United States now. In the United States alone, violent crime has increased by 500% since 1960. You see, now you see the trend. Now, prior to 1960, it was not as rampant as after 1960. You see? So that's what I said. I could prove to you that violence has really increased from the time of Noah right down to the time of Jesus. And even beyond Jesus, there is a steady rise in crime right until now. And it continues to rise. Continue to rise with time. Or increase with time. So it has increased by 500%. Let's just take some a figure at random. Let's say, for example, 100,000 people were murdered or died by violence since 1960. You know how much today it has increased by 500%. You multiply 500 by 100,000 and tell me the figure there. That's in the billion range. So there's a massive increase in the amount of violence. Now, in addition to that, let me just make this point. Now, 50 years ago, abortion, that is the murder of an unborn child, was illegal in most countries around the world. Today, abortion is legal in most countries. Abortion. You know, it's murder, by the way. It's murder. There's no excuse for it. It's murder. So, you don't kill a child in the mother's womb. That's murdering a child. Because it's just like killing a five-year-old child or a two-year-old child. It's on the same level. The only difference is that the five-year-old child or the two-year-old child will cry. But this baby in the mother's womb, even up to six, some they kill children up to 6 months in the mother's womb. You pull them out of the mother's womb and you put them on the abortion table, and the child, I understand, when you push the spear into the child and start to hack the child, the body twists, and somebody get arrested in Pennsylvania for that, some doctor, you know. But anyhow, it's murder. But the point is, getting back to the point, 46 million children are aborted each year worldwide. Now, Christians, you must hear this, right? 46 million, approximately. 46 million children are being murdered or aborted each year globally. Isn't that staggering? Staggering figure. That never happened before in human history. And telling you, man, we must take our stand as Christians, you know, to speak out against those things, because God is counted on us, even though we're not earthly bound, but we cannot be heavenly minded that we're utterly no good. So we got to speak out against injustice in the earth and wrongdoing in the earth just as well, right? So I agree with those who stand up against abortion. I stand against abortion also. I say abortion is murder. That's it. Period after that. So now, that's just a sidetracking a little bit. But tonight, I just want to emphasize that there is an increase in violence, and that just indicates that what Jesus knows what he's talking about. Of course, Jesus always know what he's talking about, and the Word of God never tells any lie. And I just want to look at some statistics here, that violence is really on the increase, as Jesus said it would be in the last days. So now, statistics on worldwide violence by WHO, World Health Organization, reliable source. All right, the sample was for the year 2000. The World Health Organization, headquarters in Geneva, in Switzerland, Geneva, okay? And the report is called World Report on Violence and Health Summary. Because they say violence affects health. But we're not talking about health. We're talking about violence concerning the prophecy that Jesus said. That the earth will be filled with violence like in the days of Noah. So now, first of all, let me just quote. Nelson Mandela, for example, said, the 20th century, that's the 1900s, the 20th century will be remembered as a century marked by violence. It burdens us with its legacy of mass destruction, of violence inflicted on a scale never seen and never possible in human history. See, Nelson Mandela, the South African, the former South African president, aged man now. So he made this statement. And this was quoted, this was included in the World Health Organization report. That's where I took these quotations. Another quotation from World Health Organization Director General. And her name is Gro Harlem Brundtland. Okay. And she said, quote, violence pervades the lives of many people around the world and touches all of us in some way. Over 1.6 million lives are lost each year, and countless more damage in ways that are not always apparent. 1.6 million people killed every year by homicide, by violence. Not necessarily, well, violence. Whatever it is, whether it's war, whether it's homicide, but violence. Not talking about auto accidents and plane crashes and stuff. So this is the a quotation made by World Health Organization Director General, saying that violence pervades the lives of many people around the world today and touch all of us in some way. 1.6 million people killed by violence every year around the world. Now three, another quotation. No country or community is untouched by violence. Images and accounts of violence pervade the media, and it's on our streets, in our homes, schools. Well, forget about schools. These days, it's like commonplace in schools now. Lockdown is something that's very common. Workplaces, yeah. Disgruntled workers return to open fire on their co-workers and their bosses. Happens. It's been happening a while now. Violence is a universal scourge that tears at the fabric of communities and threatens the life, health, and happiness of us all. You see? So now we don't like this kind of problem. You know, and as Christians, I tell you, we grieved by things that are really contrary to the things of the Spirit of God and things of the Word of God. Violence is one of those things. Of course, not use of narcotics is one of those things. But violence we're talking about now. But I'm telling you that the prophecy must come to pass. And listeners, if you, some listeners who have not yet met Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of your lives, you have an opportunity to really receive Jesus and let him change your heart. Because, you know, once you're lost, you are liable to commit violent crime easily. Because you don't have the Holy Ghost. You don't have the Spirit of God. You know, you're not guided by the Word of God. And you're not regenerated. Would you like to be a villain to commit violent crime and be part of the violence of these last days? I think your answer is no. Then you need help. Then you need Jesus. He makes the difference in the hearts of men. Give you a brand new heart, brand new start. You don't want no violence. You don't want no gun. You don't want nothing. You just know that you have God on your side and God is working things out for you. And you're serving God and you have peace and you're blessed and so on and so forth. You see? But you need Jesus. Because what's the point of saying all this and don't bring Jesus in the picture? I'm telling you. So now listen, prophecies must be fulfilled. But don't let prophecies be fulfilled on you. You have that control, you know that. Don't let prophecies be fulfilled on you. It must be fulfilled, but I'm telling you, I personally wouldn't like prophecies to be fulfilled on me. So I find myself in the ark of God and I'm staying there. I take a hold of Jesus. Jesus take a hold of me. Hallelujah. And we're walking together down this pathway of life until the end of the road. When I go to meet him in glory. Praise God. So from these quotations here, we can just conclude, hey, yes, indeed, if the World Health Organization is acknowledging in a very authentic document that worldwide violence is of interest to the World Health Organization, and it is something that needs to be attended to by the politicians of this world. Now listen to what the Secretary General of the UN said. That's the former Secretary General. That's Kofi Annan, the African guy. Violence cuts short the lives of millions across the world each year and damages the lives of millions more. Kofi Annan, Secretary General of the UN. And let's see what the stat says, you know. Just give you a little bit more details about what violence is doing. And I tell you, man, I always come across these things and it surprises me. But in the year 2000, an estimated 199,000 youths, that's the young children, 199,000 youths were killed by violence. Over 800,000 killed themselves, committed suicide. Yeah? 800,000 committed suicide. Now it's sobering, you know. You know, again, I just want to say to Christians and to everybody, you have children. You got to know each child, and each child is very unique. And each child have his own personality. And what goes for Peter does not go for Paul. So, you know, hey, you got to apply a little bit of wit that God give you a mind to, you know, to use. So, you know, this child operates this way, and this child, and you deal with this child this way, and this child this way, and that way, and so on and so forth. And every child is not the same. So you apply different measures for different children. And keep your child... monitoring your children and knowing your children very well. It's good for parents to know their children very, very well. You can't know everything, but you can know a lot of things. And help them so that they won't be frustrated and hopeless and have this very low self-esteem that will lead them to depression and uselessness and the feeling of uselessness, and then eventually resort to suicide. Very, very common among teenagers, especially. Okay. So, you know, Christians, take note, and everybody, take note of that. I believe you know those things already, but, you know, it's good to just remind people. Over 800,000 youths killed themselves in the year 2000. I'm telling you. So violence is the leading cause of death for people between the ages of 15 and 44 years. Violence, the leading cause of death people between the ages of 15 to 44 years. And by the way, violence comes in different forms. Physical violence, fights, sexual violence, psychological violence, and there's such a thing as psychological violence. Okay, let me just say this. If you damage somebody psychologically, it's severe damage. If you damage a child psychologically, oh my, you have a hard time reversing the damage. So we got to be careful, especially with those under construction, that is children. And even we as adults too. We could be very sensitive, and you know, we have to. That's why the Bible always tells us, let our words be seasoned with grace. You know, we can't just dump any old thing on one another. See, because we are human beings we have psychological beings. God made us so. we're not just physical, we're spiritual, we're psychological also. And you can damage the minds of people, believe it or not. But you know, adults deal with it a different way. They find you behaving a little bit unruly with them, they cut you off from the relationship. It shouldn't be the case. You know, Jesus teaches something different. But anyhow, it comes also in the form of neglect or deprivation. So we got to be mindful of those things, you know. And just a point I want to make here, that the point is made that the Bible prophecy has come to pass, is being fulfilled, and is continuing down the road until the end to be fulfilled. That is, the earth will be filled with violence, just as Jesus said. Just as Jesus said. Praise the Lord. So, you know, the Bible is always true. Jesus is always true. And we can count on the Bible. We can count on the words of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Prophecy number two for the night. There will be deadly diseases. But Jesus didn't say it that way. In Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24 verse 7. It reads, Matthew chapter 24 verse 7. Make sure that is 7. Yes, it's 7. Verse 7. It says here, "For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places." Now, we dealt with earthquakes the last time, and we showed that God uses earthquakes, and earthquakes play a major role in last days' actions or activities. And but now we're talking about pestilences. So in this prophecy, there shall be famines, okay, and pestilences. And this word is translated to mean diseases in the last days. Deadly diseases. Now, there were deadly diseases back then, even before Christ. There was a disease called leprosy. It's a deadly disease. And in the time of Jesus too, it was there. Leprosy. But pestilences, much more diseases, much more deadly diseases will be on stream. And also Revelation 6:8. But I'm not going to turn to that text. So now, in these last days, there are some diseases that just came on stream, just emerged, such as HIV, AIDS. HIV positive, that is AIDS, acquired immune deficiency syndrome. And then Ebola, never heard of before. In these last days, you know, in recent times, as a matter of fact, there's one called the Hanta virus, then Dengue, West Nile, SARS, which is pronounced SARS, then bird flu, etc. All these are new diseases. Well, when they say that there's nothing new under the face of the sun, but according to, you know, the record, these were not heard of in the past. Now they're heard of. Now we're hearing about these diseases. Now they're prevalent in our society. So in the last days, pestilence will be rampant, according to the prophecy here. And again, pestilences, deadly diseases. According to, let me look at a record here. We're not going to go into great details here. Time is quickly fleeting. According to the World Heart Federation now, World Heart, H-E-A-R-T, that's the organ inside of your chest cavity. According to the World Heart Federation, the number of deaths due to cardiovascular disease was 17.3 million in the year 2008. Now, let me call the real figure. This is 7.3 million. But, you know, a lot is left out. 17,327,000. That's the complete figure. Died in 2008 only of cardiovascular disease, right? That's one disease. And there are a few diseases that I want to... There's something I want to point out here. I have some information on something here that I must fine. But before I look for that, let me just put some music on. In the meantime, praise the name of Jesus. Bless the Lord. Here it is. So now, top deadly diseases of the developing world. One. Well, first of all, we're going to look at the disease. We're going to look at the yearly mortality rate. That is how much people die of the disease on a yearly basis, right? And annual infection rate. That is how many people get infected with the disease on a yearly basis. So two things. Annual mortality rate and annual infection rate. And simple, it's not sophisticated here. Annual mortality rate, how many people die every year of the disease, and annual infection rate, how many people are infected or contract the disease on a yearly basis. Now, one, that's in the developing world, okay? The developing world. So that's not in the metropolitan world. Or the cosmopolitan, like the United States and Canada and Europe and Western Europe and so on. That's other parts of the world, developing world. Okay, the Caribbean and so on. Certain parts of Africa and so on and so forth, Asia. Okay, lower respiratory infections. How many people die every year? 4 million people. How many people contract these diseases every year? There is no record. But 4 million people die every year of respiratory infection in the developing world, not the United States, mind you. 4 million. Now, two, HIV/AIDS. Annual mortality rate, that is among the people dying every year, 3 million people. How many contract the disease every year? 39.4 million people every year contract AIDS. So, you know, this figure is an eye-opening figure. 39.4 million people contracting HIV every year or AIDS every year. That tells a story here. That means a large percentage of the world population is HIV positive. Okay. Okay. Malaria. 1 to 5 million people die every year of malaria. And the amount of people contracting malaria every year is 300 to 515 million people. 300 to 515 million people contracting malaria. And some malaria, forms of malaria, deadly. But that's why they say 1 to 5 million people die every year of malaria. Okay, diarrhea. 2.2 million people die every year of diarrhea. How many people contract diarrhea on a yearly basis? 4 billion people. The population of the world is 7 billion. We're conscious of that. So, out of the 7 billion people on planet, 4 billion people contract diarrhea every year. But you know, diarrhea kills some people, yes. It kills 2.2 million people, but I think it's something that could be controlled. There's medicine for that and so on. Could be treated. Tuberculosis. Every year, 2 million people is killed by tuberculosis. And every year also, 8 million people contract tuberculosis. Measles. 530,000 people die every year of measles. And 30 million people get affected with measles every year. Whooping cough, 200,000 to 300,000 people die every year with that. 20 to 40 million contract that every year. Tetanus, 214,000 people die, and about 500,000 people contract that every year. Meningitis, 174,000 people die every year, 1 million plus contracted every year. Syphilis, 157,000 people contracted, and 157,000 people die of syphilis. That's a sexually transmitted disease. And 12.2 million contracts it every year. By the way, there's no cure for it. And you lose your sight and stuff like that. It affects your brain and all of that. So it's a dangerous time we're living in, where people are really stricken with disease. And we don't like the conditions, but the Bible's prophecy must be fulfilled. And it is being fulfilled, just like Jesus said. Amen and amen. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God, praise God. Hallelujah.
Hosanna!
Everybody!
Hosanna!
To the King!
Hosanna!
Wave and sing!
Hosanna!
Woo! Jumping in a band, Lord, and up in the air. This music so sweet, there's just nothing to compare.
Up in heaven.
Hey, if you see them angels parried in the street.
Up in heaven.
And then to my surprise, it's cold under the feet. Yeah. I watch an African with East Indians,
yeah.
Caucasian and Chinese, and then the master of the ceremony shouted something to me. It's an all inclusive, feel the celebration.
All inclusive.
This is jubilation, and
all inclusive.
Yeah, man. Jesus is.
Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Tonight I just want to say that the lines are now open. You want to call and share a testimony, you want to call and see what the Lord is doing in your life, you want to encourage the radio audience, you have a need and you want to call for prayer, you can call at any time now. The number to call is 347-663-8638. You're listening to The Hour of Truth with Brother Rennie G on Choice Radio. One more time, the number is 347-663-8638. Just want to remind you, don't forget to join the Midnight Warriors. Every night from midnight, you can join the Midnight Warriors to pray, and you can call this number. All right, 218-339-3048, and the PIN number is 3333. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. The Midnight Warriors, 218-339-3048. And the PIN number is 3333. If you're not comfortable saying 33. Bless the Lord. And don't forget, you're listening to Choice Radio, and you can tell a friend, tune on to Choice Radio. Opens 24/7. There's always a good program here for you.
For 2,000 years, the promoter,
yeah,
making preparation. You got to read up in the Gospels now to get your invitation to the all inclusive.
Bless the name of Jesus. It's a holy crusade. That's what we involve in, a holy crusade to win the lost. Win the lost. It's a warfare, spiritual warfare that we engage in. Glory to Jesus Christ. Well, continuing. Prophecy number 3 for the night. The Bible says that in the last days, knowledge would increase. Knowledge would increase. Daniel chapter 12 verse 4. And there are two prophecies in that particular text. It reads as follows. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro. And that's a prophecy we got to look at. And knowledge shall be increased. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Now, two prophecies here. But we're going to look at the one that says, knowledge shall be increased. That's in the last days, in the time of the end. Knowledge shall increase or be increased. Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. Okay. Now, I just want to say that there was always knowledge in this world. When God created man, he created him a wise human being. And man has always had knowledge. Adam had knowledge. Adam was so knowledgeable that he named the animals appropriately. So when you look at a lion looked like a lion as far as I'm concerned. You couldn't get a better name for a horse. You couldn't call a dog by a better name than dog. Or a cat by a better name than cat. Everything was... Adam just named the animals appropriately. You see? So he had knowledge. Yeah, certain amount of knowledge in him to say, okay, I'm going to name it this because it has these characteristics. Snake. I'll name snake this name because it has these characteristics, etc. So God made a mature creation and knowledge was always around. But in the last days, knowledge shall be increased. The prophecy doesn't say that knowledge would just stop. Of course not. There was always knowledge. Man has been making things. In the Old Testament times, people invented things. Solomon, for example, was specialized in making in things like fish hooks and crucibles and stuff like that for smelting metal and refining gold and all that kind of stuff. That's in the Old Testament times, in the BC period. So it's not that the man didn't have any knowledge back then to do things. He made gold rings and gold ornaments and so on. And not only gold, but other things made of metal. So the smelting of metal and so on is not something new to mankind. And there are a lot of things probably that were done back then that wasn't on the record, but it was done back then. Okay. Anyhow. But in the last days, knowledge shall be increased. And that's the word that we're really looking at here tonight in the prophecy is knowledge shall be increased. So now, there's a great improvement in the way man has been doing things. And when did this all started? Now, in Jesus' time, we can, we use the word to describe people living back there as primitive. You know, we had Bronze Age, we had Stone Age, we had all kind of different ages. And the Dark Ages and the Middle Ages, we don't have much records of what really happened. But at the same time, later on in the centuries, after the 12th century coming up, okay, from 1760 to 1850 something, some major changes occurred in the world or on the face of the earth. And these changes came about, they did not just come about without any prior knowledge. You know, there was prior knowledge that other people had worked and they had died and they came up with ideas and they had died and left their ideas behind. And then generations after worked on that. And then finally, there was a period in history, and we should know about that. And knowledge is not poison. We cannot be afraid of knowing something. Something is good to know. Okay, so there was a period of time in human history that was called the Industrial Revolution. And we ought to know that. Because a lot of the things that we have today and our way of life, or generally our ways of life, we could say it in plural form, has been enhanced by what has happened in the Industrial Revolution. And so it's important to us. But anyhow, keep it with the prophecy. Knowledge shall increase in the last days. In the during this period between 1760 and 1850, there were a lot of inventions and discoveries and explorations and stuff like that in science. And man has learned to do things differently. First of all, he has learned to make major changes in the way he grew his food. So agriculture was revolutionized. The way he made his clothes was also revolutionized. Man had learned to take cotton and make cotton clothes, and so on and so forth. But machinery was invented, and there was development in chemistry, and other developments and biology and so on that led to improvement in agriculture, led to improvement in the way man made his textile and metal, the manufacturing of metal products. There was also improvement in man's transportation, and also his economic policies and other things. For example, at what point in time the world had no trains and railroads, but after the Industrial Revolution, human beings have learned that they can invent a train, because somebody invented the steam engine in England, and they learned to use that steam engine to make trains to travel very long distances very rapidly. And one invention lead to the other. Okay, from the steam engine, we have the, how you call this engine here? The diesel engine and the gasoline engine. Okay, and so on. And then these days you have nuclear-powered machinery, or engines too, you could call it that way. But anyhow, major changes took place in the world in that period called the Industrial Revolution. And since then, that's from the period, between the period of 1760 to 1850. Prior to that, it was like primitive life. They didn't have motor vehicles on the road. They didn't manage to travel with horse and donkeys and boats. They had boats, but you know, they used to use rowboats and sailboats. And there was some camels, but these were basically the methods, and man used to use his own foot. But people, as I see in the document here, people hardly travel long distances. They rather stay within the, you know, in the vicinity of the communities, because it was hard to travel. So you can imagine Abraham back then in the time when he traveled from the land of China down in Mesopotamia, all the way through Mesopotamia and go around and then come down into the land where God wanted him to be, down in that area, down there, the promised land. You know, it was a long journey. I tell you, you know, when people sometimes boast, I'm just saying that by the way, now it's just a little side point. Sometimes we boast about, you know, I'm highly favored by God. I'm blessed and highly favored. I hope you know what that means, really. Because to be highly favored by God means that God can count on you to go through some severe adversity, and you might not be even the one to inherit the blessing that will come from your work, but others, generations after. I hope you know that. And that goes for the case of Mary and Joseph, and it goes for the case of Abraham and many others in the Bible, right? So when you say you're highly favored, also plan to endure the hardships that come with being highly favored. All right. Praise the Lord. So now, the Industrial Revolution was a time that bring about great changes, and then knowledge increased back then. Man learned to make asphalt roads and learned to build bridges and all kinds of different things man had learned to do back then. And then, as time progressed, so more inventions came on stream, because it was like a kind of a domino effect where layer by layer they keep on building on previous inventions and so on. And up to this point in time, it's still happening. The invention of the computer which is so useful to us today, it didn't happen overnight. But a number of previous inventions led to the computer. As a matter of fact, the computer systems employ a lot of old-time concepts in electronics and so on. But they improve on it and they do other things. You know, I don't have to go into the details to bore you with that. It's unnecessary. But in these last days, things have improved so much that we can see the immensity of knowledge, increase in knowledge, you know, in these last days. I tell you, it's a marvelous time that we're living in. This is called the information age, where information can travel so rapidly from one place to the other. It's amazing. Never has been in human history. So the prophecy is really, it's coming to pass. It's still being fulfilled, and it's going to continue that way, I believe, until the end of the age. That is, knowledge would increase, according to the prophet Daniel. Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. Praise the Lord. Continuing. In the last days, the Bible says, right here in Daniel chapter 12, verse 4, in another part of the verse, it says that men shall be traveling to and fro. Men shall be traveling to and fro. Multitudes will travel to and fro. So now, prior to the Industrial Revolution, few individuals traveled beyond their own communities. Until recently, horse, foot, boot, and other modes of transportation, camels, donkeys, and so on, were used. Yet today, we travel by car, bus, plane, train, subway, etc. Millions and millions are running to and fro. And the to and fro means just you traveling back and forth, just as Daniel prophesied 2,500 years ago. And I have some interesting statistics here, of course. It's a record of how people been traveling to and fro in some major areas of the world. And let me just announce at this point, you can call. The number here is 347-663-8638, and this is the Hour of Truth with Brother Energy, and you're listening to Choice Radio. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. I'll be back shortly.
Rise up.
up for Jesus. Shout out for Jesus. Jump up for Jesus. Let the enemy know that you have rights. God will help us fight. Which side are you standing on? I'm standing on the Lord's side. Stand up for Jesus. Rise up for Jesus. Shout out for Jesus. Jump up for Jesus. Let the enemy know that you have rights. God will help us fight. Which side are you standing on? I'm standing on the Lord's side. Stand up for Jesus. Rise up for Jesus. Shout out for Jesus. Jump up for Jesus. Here what we gonna do. We gonna take with slingshot and swing it around. Take your slingshot, put in your stone, swing it around, strike him down.
Take your slingshot,
let him know.
David slew the enemy, and you can do the same too. You can slay the enemy. As a matter of fact, Jesus has already slain the enemy, Satan, and we, being made through Jesus more than conquerors, we can also slay the enemy as he comes to bring defeat in our lives by taking up the sword of the Spirit, whole armor of God, as a matter of fact, and do spiritual battle. Praise God. Now, the statistics on people traveling to and fro in the last days, according to Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. Africa, in 2012, all these figures are for the year 2012. In Africa alone, 1,073,380,925 people traveled from Africa to and fro in 2012. In North America, 348,280,154 people in 2012. They traveled. In Asia, 3,922,066,987 people traveled. The Caribbean, 41,565,815 people. Latin America, 552,000,000 people. Let me take the figure again. 552,122,823 people travel. Latin America, we're talking about Central and South America. Europe, 820 million people. 820 million people, 418,446,000 people travel in Europe. Middle East, 223,608,203 people travel. That's in the Middle East. South Pacific and Australia, 35,903,569 people. And we could go on and on, but the point is made that travel will be commonplace in the last days. No point in history has man been traveling so immensely like in these last days. But again, coming back to the point that we were making all along, that what Jesus says must happen, the prophecy must be fulfilled to the letter, as Jesus said. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. And because we have some time on hand, I'm going to look at another prophecy. And this one has to do with worldwide anti-Semitism. Worldwide anti-Semitism. And it has to do with the opposition and the hatred for the Jews or people of Jewish background or national Israel. And so according to Psalm 83 verse 4 to 8 and Zechariah chapter 12 verse 2, all surrounding nations would be united against the land of Israel or the nation of Israel. That is Psalm 83 verse 4 to 8 and Zechariah 12 verse 2. And all surrounding nations would be united against Israel. And we can see that that has come to pass. It is coming to pass. As a matter of fact, it is already here and it's continuing because they haven't changed their minds. Okay. So now, this has never happened in history. According to this document, on end times prophecy, end times Bible prophecy, this hasn't happened never in history. Yet today, Israel is surrounded by Muslim nations, sown to her destruction. And the prophet said, that is Muhammad, he said, the hour, last day, the hour and then last day will not be established until you fight with the Jews. And the stone behind which a Jew will be hiding will say, oh Muslim, there is a Jew hiding behind me, so kill him. And this is quoted, this quotation is taken from the Quran. Okay, it's taken from Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 4, B 52, and Hadith number 177, okay, from the Quran. So Muhammad himself said that. So yeah, listen to the Prophet, listen to what he said. He said to them that the hour, our last day, will not be established until you fight with the Jews. And he was encouraging his people to do that. So now the nation surrounding the Jews, and it never happened in history before, but now it has happened. I mean, over a period of time now, in the last days, of course, in the 80 period, that the surrounding nations, that is the nations that surrounds Israel, which are Syria, Lebanon, to one side, I think bordering is close to Iran. Iran is not so far away; it's a good distance off, but you got to cross through Syria to get into. I'm not too sure if it's bordering there, but anyhow, Iran, all the surrounding nations, they're still surrounding nations anyway. Iraq, Iran, Syria, all the nations are wrong. They are, even Egypt, they are anti-Semitic and they're Islamic. And of course, Iran did say, or Ahmadinejad said, that his intention is to annihilate Israel, to wipe it off the face of the map. But Israel has a policy that goes like this: you kill the enemy before the enemy kills you. But that's them, you know, that's their policy. And so that's why they're very aggressive towards anybody who attacks them. They're going to be retaliating. They wouldn't back down. But this has to happen in the last days, according to Zechariah chapter 12. And there will be widespread anti-Semitism. It will be on a global level. And just listen to this, finally. Worldwide anti-Semitism. There's a report on global anti-Semitism by the U.S. Department of State, 2003 to 2004. And in that document, when I looked at it, I saw that numerous nations are really, really anti-Israel, anti-Jews. And even organizations, for example, United Nations and so on, they're not really on the Israeli side to a large extent. Even the press is not reporting objectively in favor of Israel. No, they don't do that. So there is worldwide anti-Semitism, and this is supposed to happen in the last days according to the prophecy made by Zechariah and also in the Psalms. But I just want to say, and well, let me just conclude this. And it comes in many forms. The anti-Semitism comes in many forms. One, there is traditional anti-Jewish prejudice. That is, some people from generation to generation, they were taught to hate Jews. And there is also strong anti-Israeli sentiment. People just have that they blame the Jews for certain things that's going on in the world. Anti-Israeli sentiment. Anti-Jewish sentiment is similar to anti-Israeli sentiment. And then also criticism of the Jews or the nation of Israel by other nations. Criticism. And holding the Jews responsible or Israel responsible for chaos in the Middle East. And lots of nations are doing that. And the United Nations is doing that also. So yeah, this is the truth. What can I say? I have to say. So these are some of the prophecies that I wanted to share with you tonight as prophecies of the last days. There are many more. And this is all in keeping with the theme that I started on about 2 months ago or something like that. That the Bible is really authentic. And these are some of the subtopics that I said we would have to cover to show that we know that the Bible is true, but it's always good to get into some details. To it makes us, I think, it makes us stronger. It makes us even more assured. I don't know for you, but I know it's for me. It does. It does. It helps me. So we've been looking at 7 compelling evidences that the Word of God is indeed authentic. 7 compelling pieces of evidences. Under the categories of 1, God's character, 2, claims of divine authorship, 3, the unity of the Bible, 4, fulfilled Bible prophecy or prophecies, 5, scientific accuracy, 6, archaeological finds, and 7, the Bible's life-changing power. Now, we have covered 6 of these subtopics. The only one left is God's character. We didn't touch on God's character. To show that the consistency of God's character from Genesis to Revelation is an indication that the Bible is authentic. I don't even have to go there, but maybe I'll touch on that. You know, I think I'm going to include it in the next program. But just remember, we covered all these claims of divine authorship. You can't forget that. Claims of divine authorship, 40 authors, everybody consistent. I'm not going to go back to review everything. The unity of the Bible. All stories just synchronize with each other. Non-contradicting each other. And those they try to forge into the Bible, like the apocryphal books, couldn't make it in there because they contradict themselves to begin with. Let alone contradicting the other books, 66 books. Fulfilled Bible prophecies, we did talk about that. A lot of prophecies have been fulfilled already in Old Testament times. And some have been even fulfilled in the New Testament times. Already, and some are in the process of being fulfilled. Scientific accuracy, we did discuss that recently, that the Bible, actually, science confirms the Bible. Science confirms the Bible. We discussed that in a recent program. And we saw that the Bible is really scientifically accurate, and that science actually stumbled on some error where the Bible already established that this was not the case, but had it already established the truth about the matter. And we went through a checklist of those things, such as the earth is a sphere. The Bible does say that the earth is a sphere. And whereas science was saying that the Bible was as flat as a disc. And now they come to believe that the earth is a sphere. And that the stars in the sky are innumerable, or they cannot be counted, according to Jeremiah 33:22. And science was saying, oh, there are only 1,100 stars in the sky. And the earth, science was saying that the earth sat on a larger animal one time. And the Bible was saying in the book of Job, chapter 26, verse 7, that the earth was floating free in space. You see, the Bible is really, really accurate, and it confirms, science confirms the Bible. The Bible don't confirm science, because science have a lot of lies just as well. As much as science does a lot of good, and a lot of things that are invented through science, and there's a lot of scientific development and so on, sophistication and so on and so forth, and helps out in life. At the same time, there are a lot of error and lies in science. Point blank. A lot of errors and lies in science. But the Bible is really accurate. So I exalt this book. We exalt this book. This book is wonderful. You know, there's a lot of other things. The wind blew in straight lines. One time science believed that. Whereas the Bible says, hey, in Ecclesiastes 1:6, the wind blows in cyclones. Then science later on come to believe that the wind blows in cyclones. And the story goes on and on and on. And blood is the source of life and health, according to Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11. Science believed that sick people must be bled. The blood must drain out from their bodies so that they could get healed. And now they come to believe that blood is the source of life. So, hey, you better give people a blood transfusion rather than draining the blood. So, you can see here that from discussing these subtopics, and by the way, we also touch to a large extent on archaeological finds, and we found out that, or we discussed that there are so many archaeological finds that confirms Bible stories. As a matter of fact, 100% of the archaeological finds were pertaining to the Bible were accurate. That is, proved the Bible accurate. Sorry, and so. Tonight, we have no other discourse but to believe the Word of God, to count on this great book that God has given. So, Christians tonight, just remember. Now, I'm concluding this. Actually, I'm going to discuss God's character. That's just the one final point. That's in another program. But you can see, I'm about to conclude on this topic of the authenticity of the Bible. And we should have no doubts left in our minds concerning the Bible, because sometimes I think Christians even go through that period in their life when they doubt some things in the Bible. Oh, is Noah's story true? Is the flood true? Is this who? Did Jonah? Was Jonah really swallowed by a fish? Did he really went to Nineveh? And so on. And but all these now, we can say for sure that as impossible as they look, they're really, really authentic. That they're true. The stories are just, they occurred just as the Bible said it, at the time when the Bible said it occurred. And the people who were involved are the same people, the real people that were really involved in the account, and so on and so forth. So hey, tonight, we just want to thank God that we have the Word of God with us, in our possession. We can read. We can know about God. We can know about the will of God. We can know what God says wrong to do, what God says right to do, what God says pertaining to our lives, how we can be saved, how we can avoid going to hell, how we can go to heaven, how we can live victoriously, how we can be blessed, you know, and all the works, how a church should run, how a pastor should behave himself, how Christians should conduct themselves in relation to the pastors, how we should behave in relation to the world. Everything is answered in the Bible. So we have no excuse for living unrighteously and living in defeat and all that stuff. Right? So I trust, based on this series of programs, that those of you who listen to the program would have come to a greater faith in God's word, and a greater appreciation for God's word. I think we even mentioned the translation of the Bible, you know, through the years, the development, you know, of the canon, and how it was put together, and then how it was held back from human beings. It was held back from the ordinary man, and then how finally it was released by God's power, of course, using men. and so we have it today. And I just thank God for the Bible, and I appreciate it very much. And tonight, Christians, I just want to encourage you to read the Bible with your children and tell them how important the Bible is, how important the Bible is to Christians, to the church, and how it can make a difference in their lives, how it should be used by them to govern their lives, to control them, to tell them what's wrong and right, and so on and so forth. Your children and others, those who teach Sunday school, emphasize the importance of the Bible, the truthfulness of the Bible, the trustworthiness of the Bible. Just emphasize the Bible. You exalt the Bible, you exalt the Word of God, you exalt God at the same time. And then the children will know, or whoever it is, the new convert, they will know that this is really, really sound and good authority. And this is absolute authority, as a matter of fact. So they cannot be fooled in this world. And chances of going astray will be reduced drastically. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So the time is quickly vanishing away and coming down to the end of the program. In a few minutes, I'll be off the air. If there's anybody you want to call and just say something, share a testimony, or say what the program means to them, you can call in right now. You want to encourage the audience, you can do so. I just want to read some scriptures, what the Word of God has to say about itself one more time. Praise the Lord. The Word of God. For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproofs of instruction. And reproofs of instruction are the way of life. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Psalm 119 verse 105. And Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12. Praise the Lord. Such the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. John chapter 5 verse 39, the words of Jesus. The holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. And all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instructions in righteousness. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15 and 16. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Romans chapter 10 verse 17. And finally, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Joshua 1:8. But remember that we are not keeping the law as such. But the book of the law is the word of God. And what pertains to us today is the new covenant teachings, not the old covenant teachings. Praise the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. So thank you tonight for listening to this broadcast. I got about 2 more minutes left here. Praise the name of Jesus. Okay, I just want to tell you to walk with Jesus this week. in prayer, be victorious. Commit yourself to the Lord. Remember the first exhortation, sorry, I gave you at the beginning of the program. Okay. If your faith is tested by fiery trials, just remember to lean on Jesus Christ, to lean on the Lord, to depend upon His Word, to trust in His Word. Believe what His Word says. And be in prayer. Also include some fasting in your prayer. And God, in His time, I don't know how long it's going to take, but God, in His time, will bring deliverance. He will answer your prayers and He will bring you out.
Come on and pour the oil. Come help this wounded child.
Help this wounded child.
Cover me with the blanket.
Cover me
of your love.
With the blanket of your love. Lord, break the bread.
Come, Lord, anoint my head.
Anoint my head.
Administer healing to me.
Your healing.
Don't let another wounded.
Don't let another wounded. Another wounded. Another wounded. Another wounded soldier. Don't let me die. When I was wounded, I put out a desperate cry for help.
Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I just thank you for what you allowed me to share tonight with the radio audience. And I just pray that God, Christians will be edified, or they would have been edified, and that they would retain this information in their minds, in their souls, knowing that, let it be a confirmation to them that, one more time, that your word is true, and that what Jesus said really is coming to pass and has come to pass, some of them. And sure, what those that have not yet come to pass, the prophecies will come to pass. And it's just a matter of time. And I just praise the name tonight, God, for those who have listened and have been blessed. And those who are maybe don't know Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, I pray, Lord God, that you may challenge their hearts to come to faith in Jesus Christ, to realize that your word is true. And that you are calling them to a life of holiness, a life where God will receive, they will be in the right relationship with you, receive your saving grace and be in the right relationship with you. So I pray, O Lord, that you may challenge the hearts of the lost world who have heard the message tonight. And I pray, O Lord, for this radio station, that it may continue to function, God, by your favor. Hallelujah. So continue to provide for the management to take care of business here, and that programming will be really biblical. In the name of Jesus, God, all who have listened to me tonight, God, I pray that God, you may give them a victorious week and bless their lives. Pray that God, they may bear fruit for you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Come, Lord, and pour the oil. Come help this wounded, come help this wounded, come help this wounded child.
Cover me with the blanket of your love.
Come, Lord, and break the bread. Come, Lord, and anoint my head, anoint my head.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Ah. Death is not a popular subject. In fact, most people would like to just ignore it until one of these days, somewhere out there, they have to face it in reality. Well, God certainly does not want us to be overshadowed by the very idea of the thoughts of death, but neither does he want us to ignore the whole idea, for the simple reason that he says in his word, it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment, that it is inescapable. There is no way to escape death unless the Lord Jesus Christ comes. It is inevitable in every person's life. So the question is this: are you ready to meet the Lord? How do you want to leave this life? What do you want to leave behind? And so people have... aspects of death. One of them is this. That is physical death. That is a separation.